Welcome to the Libertarian Counterpoint. I'm Richard Fields. On the program today, we have Gerald Clift, who ran for the position of supervisor of Solano County. Came in a very close third. Back in June. We have Lance Christensen, who is the director of the Reason Foundation's Pension Reform Project. Welcome to the program, gentlemen. The Pension Reform Project was, I'm guessing, dealt a little bit of a blow when a judge in Ventura County decided that a pension reform measure should not appear on the November ballot.
Yeah, a little bit. I think it was kind of difficult for a lot of people who had been through the process, had created a pretty sensible reform measure that was acceptable to most of the public and all the polling they did, collected significantly more signatures than they needed to, and had it all the way to the finish line despite all the best efforts of the supervisors to try to quash it, and then to have a judge basically say, well, you went through the process, did everything the right way, but just because the people put it on the ballot doesn't mean you can take it off. That's got to be disheartening, and for us, it was a little disappointing. We thought
what was his legal reason?
His legal reason was that the legislature had placed this before the people, that the legislature had to be the one to say that they had to come, that they could come out off the ballot, and it didn't say it's silent on it in the statute. Which to me, I think you defer to the people if the people decide they want to vote something off the.
Is this something that can be appealed and tried in the future?
They could have. I think what they're going to do is step back and look at what's happening statewide and try to determine if there's a broader recourse for all the cities and counties in the state that really want some access and control of the pension reform process.
For those of us who are on the outside looking in, we just look at the state of California, which is in perpetual budget deficit territory and doesn't seem to know what to do about it. And we hear that a big part of the problem are bloated public sector pensions. You've been studying this for a while. What are the reasons that pensions are throwing California's budgets, both at the state and at the local level, into jeopardy?
You have lots of different reasons. One, the legislature and elected officials for many generations have dedicated far more benefits than there was money to pay for them, and a lot of times for election favors or other things. They've also had...
Is this a case where the union support you
sure.
for city council or for county supervisor or for state legislature, and in the quid pro quo is you better vote for our pension benefits?
Sure, wink, wink, you know, make sure you can help us out in the long run. The argument used to be that if you work for the state or for the city, you didn't make as much money as the private sector, but that would be balanced out when you did your public service and the pension is on the back, and you would make sure that you would get a decent pension for the rest of your life. Mm-hmm. To guarantee that means that the taxpayer is basically footing the bill when your assumptions are all off and your investments don't come to fruition, which is the other part of the problem. I don't begrudge anybody having a pension. I have no problem with the retirement system. What I have a problem with is over-promising, writing checks that the legislators, city councilors, supervisors couldn't cash.
Well, from what I understand is they're making agreements to fund pensions, and then when it comes time to write the check, not writing it.
Right, exactly. Or they're not, they're not making their normal cost payments. Pensions are not like Social Security. Pensions are pre-funded, so every person you're paying for their full fare. You're hoping that whatever assumptions you have in their life, on their health, on their mortality rates, how long they'll be retired, that you calculate that into a really complex formula and you come back with a rate of contribution and then also investment. And they're finding that they're overinflating the numbers on what they're going to get in return on investment, but that they're under, you know, counting how many years they're going to live.
So they're assuming they're going to make 8% on investments and coming in with 6%, something like that.
Right, and they do that so they don't have to pay as much on the front end.
Okay.
And so that saves their general budget.
So it's a classic case of rosy projections not coming to pass.
But intentionally.
Yeah.
Yes, they know this.
Yeah.
For years and years and years, they've not reached, most of the time, 6.5% is about as good as it gets.
Mm-hmm.
Every once in a while, you have these times where the economy's good. It's booming, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11%. The problem is they don't factor in all those times where it dropped below. And you have to not only make up for your loss, but also for your missed mark that year, too.
Mm-hmm.
And that can take sometimes 5, 10, 20 years to fix that hole. Mm-hmm. And if you're not paying your full fare at the front end, if you're only paying 60, 70, 80% of what you're supposed to pay every year, that's money that's not going into a bank account that's not being
collected. So how can they legally do that? How can say, a county board of supervisors say, we're going to fund pensions at X number of dollars per year, and then simply not do it? How is that legal?
In the private sector, you would go to jail.
Exactly.
Right. So what they did is they wrote a completely separate standard for government sector employee pensions, and which basically says, it's more of a suggestion, we would like that you do 100%, but you know, you've got to do what you got to do because of tax, you know, taxes or budgetary pressures. That's not any different than a business. The business has got to decide how much money it's getting in. And that's why you've seen in the private sector over the last 30 years, they've reduced their public pension, or excuse me, their public pension, their defined benefit pensions, and they've converted it to defined contribution, your 401k sort of retirement systems. Because once you put the money in, you're not responsible anymore for what the outcome is.
Go ahead. Do you think part of the problem is the top-heavy management aspect of it? I mean, obviously, it's a $300 billion pension liability, according to Stanford, so not the large part. But I was reading an editorial in the San Francisco Chronicle that cited a study by California Common Sense, which claimed that over the last two decades in the UC system, for every one regular employee, like a teacher or a regular workforce employee, they were hiring five management or management support staff. And they made up as much as 20% of the salaries. So it seems like that's kind of exploding exponentially as a problem as well for the pension system.
Oh, sure. I mean, and that's when you take a government and you make it bigger than it really needs to be. The UC system is a little bit separate from CalPERS. They suffer from a lot of the same problems, though. When you have a bloated government bureaucracy, you're going to pay more for it, and all those people are going to get pensions, and they're going to, as the governor found out recently, live longer than they expected they were going to.
Well, yeah, I mean, with medical advances and so forth, people are living longer. I'm sure probably early retirement has something to do with that as well, which is also a big thing in the public sector.
And it happens a lot with law enforcement, which are usually your higher cost. They'll leave with, you know, 80-90%. It was legal to spike a lot of their pay.
Tell me what the spiking
is. What they would do is they would take up unused sick time or vacation. Maybe they got some sort of promotion at the end of their career. Their highest salary might be bumped at the very end for a short period of time, enough to take whatever salary it is and increase it for their retirement.
So the pension is based on the last salary? Is that the way it works?
In California, it's usually the highest year's salary. Mm-hmm. But yeah, if you're the captain, they call it captain's disease. It's you're a captain for about a year, and then, oops, you get sick and retire. And it happens on a regular basis. So.
Yeah, there was actually a Wall Street Journal editorial that claimed that when you factor in the overtime work, the last year, the graduating from the California Prison Guard Academy is actually more lucrative than graduating from Harvard.
Yeah, not bad.
Yeah. Well, obviously, you know, the whole pension problem is a problem that cannot exist in perpetuity. And we're seeing bankruptcies now in Vallejo, San Bernardino, and Stockton, and I'm assuming that's probably the fate, and also Mammoth Lakes. I'm assuming that's kind of the fate of a lot of the local governments as well as the state government.
There's a research study done by the Center of Retirement Research at Boston College, so a pretty esteemed place, where they said that pensions are not the cause for bankruptcies across the country, except in California. Except in California. In California,
always in the vanguard.
Cost, yeah, hey, we're number one, right?
Yeah.
We lead. And in California, the way that it works is that a lot of these systems are so bloated that people take advantage of the system. And it's unfortunate. I mean, if we're trying to encourage people to do a good job in a particular position, we want to give them the benefits they deserve. But we've also max it so hard that they're going to make a lot more money in retirement than they did when they were working.
Now, in bankruptcy, of course, I guess the standard has been the pensions are off limits. But a bankruptcy judge in the Stockton bankruptcy is saying otherwise or not?
Yeah, Judge Klein, he made a ruling on October 1st A little background in Stockton. Stockton decided not to touch CalPERS. They looked what happened in San Bernardino and other places where they tried to address CalPERS, and CalPERS says, well, listen, you can get out of the system if you pay full fare. Well, that's like adding up your mortgage and saying you're going to pay it on the spot. For them, they couldn't do that, and the costs were so high and exorbitant that they said, okay, we won't do that. But instead of challenging CalPERS like San Bernardino and others have done, where they didn't pay for a period of time, Stockton said, we won't touch them, we'll leave them harmless, but we will cut our bondholders pretty tremendously. And when they did that, the bond guys were like, we're investing you as a city.
And that's sort of like the Chrysler, the GM bailout where the bondholders got skinned and the unions were protected.
Yeah.
Same principle?
Exact same principle. Exact same principle. It was public sector this time. Mm-hmm. But who's going to want to invest in a city that is virtually in bankruptcy? So how are you going to get
by invest, you mean by municipal bonds?
Municipal bonds, who's going to want to help you pay for your roads that need to be fixed, your pipelines, infrastructure? California has a huge problem. It's water infrastructure. It's years old. Energy, San Ramon, you know, these places where your gas pipes are old. Who's going to invest in these places and bring it up to snuff if they know something happens, they're not going to get their money back out of the system?
Okay, so that happened in Stockton?
In Stockton, what happened was Franklin Templeton was one of the major bondholders there. They were getting pennies on the dollar. And they basically said, no, we're not going to take the agreement, and took him to court. And that's where Judge Klein said, okay, well, I have decided, this is October 1st in his oral opinion, that pensions can be touched in bankruptcy. They can. But when it came back, Stockton didn't adjust their plan. They allowed the CalPERS to go pretty much scot-free, still punishing Franklin Templeton. Well, in the short run, yeah, maybe it was good for CalPERS, but I think in the long run, as other cities think about the costs of bankruptcy, which are high.
So you're saying Klein reversed himself?
He didn't reverse himself. He just approved the plan that Stockton put before them, which did not include impairing CalPERS.
Does that
make sense?
Yeah.
And so in the future, I think you're going to have cities. Bankruptcy is not a cheap proposition. It's in the $10, $15, $20 million range usually when you go through this process. I think they're at $41 million in Stockton with all the lawsuits.
You're talking about all the legal fees?
Lawsuits, legal fees, you know, all the sort of stuff you have to go through to get to that place. If you think about it, that's an expensive proposition. But if you're a city like L.A., what's $40 million to you if you have billions of dollars of liabilities?
Yeah,
something to think about.
So what's the upshot? I mean, are pensions now on the table?
Yes, but who's going to challenge CalPERS? Big question. If you're a small city, you're not going to take them on.
Because of the legal costs.
Legal costs and intimidation. They're the big guns. $290 billion of assets. That's a chunk of change to deal with. So,
tell me what you are doing with the Reason Foundation in addressing the whole pension issue.
What we're doing is we're going around the country and we're identifying places that have been harmed by their pension costs. Most of these are in systems that are defined benefit. In other words, the taxpayer is guaranteeing whatever pension benefit they have for the rest of their life. Once you put somebody in the system, that's 6 years, you're basically married to that person for 60 or 70 years. So you've got to cover their costs for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And so what we're saying is we need to find a way where the taxpayer is not on the hook, where it's fair, open, and transparent, and where the government is actually paying their fair share. And if we can do that, most of these are a defined contribution system. It can be a hybrid system. It can be what they call a cash balance, which is a mini defined benefit, but it's very controlled. There's a lot of different ways we can do it. It's not a cookie cutter system, but we bring in the tools, the research and the analysis necessary for them to go through that process.
So you're acting as a consultant to cities in the sense.
For instance, I've been working with several cities in the Midwest mm-hmm. who have pension problems, hundreds of millions of dollars of unfunded liabilities, and we walk in and say, okay, here's where your problems are. Here are the areas where your benefits may be too generous, maybe your calculations for benefits need to change, maybe your pension board governance needs to improve or change. And we help make recommendations. They go through the process, and we back them up with whatever information, analysis, or research that they need.
Mm-hmm. And are you finding that governments are willing to take that perhaps unwelcome advice?
Yeah, some are. Some aren't. But, you know, the ones that aren't, they're the ones that are going to be going through the bankruptcy process. I mean, they're just, at this point in time, because of the economic, you know, sort of recessionary impacts over the last, you know, 8-ish years, a lot of these cities have borrowed so much money for so long they can't just go paycheck to paycheck anymore. So if there's a big breakdown in the economy, if 2015 is not as great as it should be, then a lot of these governments are going to be on the cusp of huge, huge costs.
So you're providing the tough love when people are hitting rock bottom.
Sometimes, yeah.
Interesting, interesting role to be playing.
I'm very favorite. I'm the favorite guy at the party. So.
I think a recent foundation evaluated Ventura County's a potential initiative, right? And said it would save over $2 billion.
Yeah, it was somewhere around there. It was about $1.8 billion of saved money in the long run over 30 years.
Yeah.
That's a chunk of change.
Mm-hmm. Are you optimistic or pessimistic on whether or not California in particular will be able to get out of its pension dilemma?
Well, look what happened recently. CalPERS went and changed its formula, basically thumbing its nose at the governor, and allowed for this pension spiking. 99 different specialty pays, you know, for librarians to shelve books, for heaven's sake, isn't that what a librarian's for? But they get paid more for it. And because you're bumping up their pay, you're bumping up their pension. And as they allow this for the benefit base pay, your costs are going to be tremendously higher in the long run.
Yeah, I remember reading that list of stuff like Microsoft Office proficiency, right? Just like little things they could just tack on that are hard to evaluate whether or not you even have those skills.
Yeah, it's good to be a public sector worker, you know, and to have these sorts of add-ons. Again, there's a certain level of government that we have to provide for some services. We can debate about how big or small that should be. But the fact that we're paying people more to do something that they should be doing in the first place for that particular job is ridiculous.
What's the next step?
The next step in California is for the governor to actually be realistic about what's going on. I think he needs to give the local governments more control and the ability, constitutionally, for them to make changes in their pension systems. That doesn't mean that all of them are going to go and completely reform, but at least they can make some tweaks where it makes sense.
You say that's in the power of the governor's office?
It would be in the power if he wanted to do it legislatively.
Well, now that we have presumably Jerry Brown and is in his last term as governor, is he going to find the intestinal fortitude to do what's necessary?
It would be a tremendous change from the first term where he empowered all of this chicanery.
Okay, even though he did have experience at the local government level and probably knows what he's getting into.
Just like CEQA, he'll find his way around it when it suits his needs.
Okay. Well, it's an interesting issue. Another interesting issue that I find just absolutely fascinating is an article that was written by Patrick Kennedy. He wrote an op-ed against legalizing marijuana. And I find that to be absolutely amazing. How about you, Gerald?
Yeah, I mean, especially the arguments he was giving in his editorial. I mean, it was things like... he's concerned because in the states that have legalized it, they've seen more visits to the emergency room. He doesn't mention at all that no one, you know, died or had overdoses of it. Maybe people were just concerned when they were taking it or more apt to go seek treatment when they're taking it. That's part of the problem of a black market system. You know, it pushes people into the shadows and might get something that isn't marijuana and not go to the hospital. Something might actually happen, like spice. K2 is a perfect example of that. It's an artificial marijuana synthetically made that actually can cause people to die and have seizures, all sorts of stuff. The other thing he was focusing on is that it's going to be turned into big tobacco. Everyone's going to be marketing marijuana to people. And so that's going to essentially ruin the world, even though you know his grandpa certainly made a lot of money doing that.
I was going to say, has he forgotten his roots? It was Joseph Kennedy that made money first as a bootlegger, and second, mm-hmm. When booze was legalized after Prohibition was repealed, he positioned himself to make a huge fortune. I mean, that's where the Kennedy family fortune comes from, is from the alcohol trade, which he was able to essentially corner early on.
Yeah, the exact reason why he has a voice.
And of course, Patrick has been able to make very good use of his grandfather's products, as well as the black market products, in his own checkered career. What I don't understand is how somebody like that can have the gall to come out with an op-ed that says this is bad because somebody's going to make money on it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's capitalism. We can't have that.
Yeah.
Even though Grandpa did fairly well, because it wasn't capitalist, it was more mercantilist. But
Well, it's more frustrating too is just the whole premise of his argument that it's going to be easier for children to access. It just kind of goes contrary to everything we've seen. Like the National Center for Addiction and Substance Abuse says that 86% of teenagers who use marijuana started at or before age 15, and goes on to say that teenagers have easier access to marijuana than alcohol, a legal substance. And the difference is when you go to, like, you know, 7-Eleven, try to buy alcohol, and you don't have an ID, they're worried about selling it to you because they're going to lose access to all their legal sales. But if you're making all your deals in the shadows, selling drugs to anybody, you don't really care because all your sales are illegal. So really his whole argument, if he's truly trying to prevent access to kids, is really detrimental to that purpose.
Which is the whole drug, the whole argument in favor of making drugs legal in the first place.
Very true.
Yeah. The Weather Channel founder, John Coleman, says that climate change is baloney. And of course, the IPCC says otherwise. They say that doom will befall us unless we get rid of all fossil fuels by the end of the century. With a 95% certainty, how do they come up with a 95% certainty? And does John Coleman have any meteorological qualifications?
You would think so, right? consensus science is one of my favorite things. I love the Michael Crichton debate and discussion where he says consensus is the issue of politics, not of science. And I think we try to debate the merits on in a political manner and see, you know, how many scientists versus other scientists believe this is true. The art of science is proving things are wrong. So you should always be challenging things. And if people believe that humans have some impact, great or small, I'm in the camp where humans are part of the environment. And when a volcano spews lots of CO2, well, it's still CO2. We have to deal with it. So getting all the cars off the highway didn't stop that. How do we learn to deal with those issues and after effects? But when you have a guy like this come out and say, listen, you know, this really is a bunch of garbage, and it's been a way for people to make lots of money, and researchers, especially those that want government grants, are going to go where the government pays the money. So, you know, follow the money, right?
Well, yeah, that's interesting you say that, too, because the New York Times had a comprehensive article on the split between meteorologists and climatologists, whereas climatologists are almost universally in agreement that their climate change is a huge problem and it's caused by man. Meteorologists are more split, and, in fact, as much of a third of them do not see it as, or only about a third of them see it as a significant issue. So it's interesting. You know, it's hard to know how much is causation versus correlation. There was another study that was covered in the Associated Press that found that the natural changes in wind patterns in the ocean could be attributed largely to the warming we've seen. That has nothing to do with CO2. So, I mean, I'm sure there is some impact done from humans. I mean, our population just more than doubled in the last century. So just the CO2 we're exhaling is more CO2 in the world. But I think in light of all the other environmental issues that we have in the world, I don't think that this really rises to the level that it's portrayed as our, you know, existential crisis in humanity.
Well, I've always wondered why global warming is considered that much of a problem anyway. I mean, if you think about it, we have a very cold northern hemisphere, and most of the landmass is in the northern hemisphere. What is so bad about, you know, growing sugarcane in Siberia?
You know, in the medieval times, actually, they grew a lot of grapes up in England, and Greenland was
green. Yeah,
you know, and there was a reason. It wasn't a myth. It actually happened.
Right.
And people were actually prosperous, and things all right. Things were all right. I would prefer a warmer world. You know, it's been a little chilly lately. But that being said, when anybody tries to guess more than 2 weeks out the weather, let alone the climate, I think that's a tenuous sort of place to stand. And the fact of the matter, the facts right now show that 18 years there's been no warming at all. If we're going to run around and say, hey, the world's warming at a crazy rate, at least back it up with some sort of facts.
Yeah, I'm following Al Gore's example. I'm buying a beachfront property.
Hey, Montecito's beautiful, right? Right there on the beach, not too far away. I'll believe it's a crisis when those who say it's a crisis start acting like it's a crisis.
Exactly. Yeah. Arnold Abbott, he's a 90-year-old fellow, and a couple of pastors in Fort Lauderdale were arrested for feeding the homeless. As Arnold tells the story, he was feeding a homeless on a beach feeding operation, and the cop came up to him and said, "Drop that plate now." What? What's going on? Why?
No, I mean, this is just outrageous from the stance that you shouldn't be criminalizing nonviolent behavior or consensual nonviolent behavior, and just somebody would criminalize giving food to the most needy in our population. It's just baffling to me. I am glad to see, though, that the 90-year-old Abbott, was his name?
Right? Arnold Abbott, yeah.
That he says he's going to go right back out there and do it again. He's already announced that, you know, it's not going to stop him. He's going to go in jail if he has to. And unfortunately, it is a trend, though. I've been seeing more and more cities pass laws like this. The first one I remember was about 2 years ago. I remember Michael Bloomberg saying that he had to do it, you know, nanny state. New York said that we have to monitor. We have to outlaw giving food to the homeless because otherwise we can't ensure that they're getting the right fat, fiber, and salt content. That's obviously, rather them die and starve to death than have too much fat. Just totally baffling to me that we could be in a situation like this.
Is that an excuse than any state rationale? Is that just an excuse for the real reason, which is NIMBY?
I could be in not in my backyard. I think probably most of these laws that are passing are in the not in my backyard area. But I Bloomberg is a special type of beast, and I think that maybe he just truly believes that he knows best for everyone.
Well, no, seriously, why would a city, and it's not just Fort Lauderdale or New York, it's also happened in Southern California and other jurisdictions, why would a city council or a county board of supervisors say, we're not going to allow private individuals to feed the homeless? You know, what's the rationale for that? I don't understand that.
It's power and control. If they can stop people from doing something under the guise of being the better person, it focuses more on their resources and them as having the ability to make more government programs.
Also, in other words, they have a monopoly on feeding the homeless, and they want to protect that monopoly?
I think that's a possible reason. I don't think it's the only reason, but it's a possibility.
Okay. Well, that would explain it a little bit.
Yeah.
What is the best libertarian way of going about taking? I mean, obviously, we would support a guy like Arnold Abbott that says, you know, I'm going to go out and do a loaves and fishes kind of thing in the private sector, you know, do what I can to make life easy for people who are having a hard time. That's a libertarian answer to any kind of social welfare problem, right?
I think pretty generally, yeah. It's about letting people go where there's a perceived need and do something they feel good about.
And the opposite, the safest solution is that's our monopoly. We will maintain control over that. Just vote for us and we'll take care of you.
That's right.
Okay. Now I understand. Thank you very much for being a part of the show, Libertarian Counterpoint, on the air on Channel 17 in Sacramento and cable channels all over the place elsewhere. Check your local listings also on YouTube and on the web at www.accesssacramento.org. Thank you very much. We'll see you again next week. Thank you.